In the early 80s, rock music was a withering wasteland.
There wasn't anybody really pushing the boundaries of rock.
Then came five lads from Sheffield to set things straight.
We could really kick rock music up the ass.
We weren't going to settle for second best. An album is for life.
Nothing was going to stop that record.
Def Leppard traded their soul to a devil for detail.
He knew what he wanted. He knew how to get it.
Mutt saying, look, you can do it better.
I really don't want to do this. It's insane.
You do that one more time and you're out.
I was having a breakdown.
I just bawled my eyes out. I can't sing.
After the smoke had cleared, they'd forged a metal masterpiece that resuscitated rock and roll.
Wow, that's it.
When this record came out, it was just like, whoa.
A zillion voices.
He just slammed home.
They definitely raised the bar.
That was the British invasion for me.
Pyromania was like rock and roll 101.
Had a big impact on my life.
It has to play some kind of role on our music.
There's five major hits on it that you'll still hear today.
It still holds up. You can still blast it.
I always have a copy of it in my collection.
Def Leppard's Pyromania is an ultimate album.
It's great music, and great music lives and lasts forever.
Def Leppard's Pyromania landed in 1983 and altered the landscape of rock and roll.
I don't know anybody that could put that record on and not just go, man, what, this is a killer record. They definitely raised the bar.
If people look back in time to the importance of some of these great records like Led Zeppelin II or The Beatles' Sgt. Pepper's, that Def Leppard's Pyromania record will be there on the top 10 list.
In the early 80s, radio had lost its way. Rock fans were looking for a band to call their own. Punk was too marginal. Heavy metal was too obsessed with the occult. A new wave seemed to be more of a fleeting fashion. Pure rockers felt abandoned.
Albums in 1982 pretty much sounded like rock, American rock albums from 1977. There wasn't anybody really pushing the boundaries of rock.
All the audiences were fragmented as far as what they liked. They had their favorite brand of music, and they didn't want to lean too far and try anything else or experience anything else. They just wanted to support their own little area.
The music industry had hit hard times, with the world economy sinking deeper into recession. Spare change went to dinner tables, not turntables.
It was pre-CD. It was really pre-almost hair metal. You had this funny time when a lot was happening, but nothing exploding.
Then, in early 1983, came a feel-good record rock fans could embrace, Pyromania.
We wanted to try and make it a little bit more accessible to people that wouldn't necessarily buy Black Sabbath albums.
It certainly was able to bridge the gap between the really hard metal people and also the traditional rockers that were afraid to really lean that far because it was so commercial, it was so pleasant, and yet at the same time, it was really rocking.
You can be riding down the road. This may not even be your kind of band, but you're riding down the road and the music comes on and you find yourself, like I said, going, fool, you
Nearly two decades later, and with sales in excess of a staggering 10 million copies, Pyromania's melodic riffs still managed to influence bands the world over. Why don't think you trust in
my self-righteous suicide? Pyromania was definitely my first stage experience, except there was nobody there in my living room. It was a big part of my childhood, so it has to play some kind of role on our music.
Pyromania is like rock and roll 101. It sounds like a well-produced garage band to me, you know, which is, you know, what we always go for.
If you listen to our album Atomic, the intro to the record, we just basically ripped off Die Hard the Hunter by Pyromania. When I listen to Pyromania now, I'm like, I knew we sort of lifted that.
Def Leppard were unlikely heroes from Sheffield, a city previously most famous for its steel. They were working class kids that stumbled into rock and roll history.
They came from nothing, and I really do mean nothing, but they came of like industrial Sheffield, and they wanted to go to America.
We were all factory workers by force, not by choice. It's what you did if you came from Sheffield. You went to work in a factory. I just didn't want to do it till I was 65.
The industrial North had a great tradition of forging quality metal acts. Northerners proudly claimed acts like Iron Maiden and Judas Priest as their own. Sheffield had no such love for Leppard. One hometown critic once called the band the worst group ever to have graced this city with its presence. Not surprisingly, Leppard wanted out.
They wanted something more for themselves, and they were willing to work really hard to get it.
It was better than working for British Rail, installing car radios, driving a taxi, which is what some of their fathers have been doing.
By 1982, their first two albums had sold a combined tally of 500,000 copies. Yet they still had to stick to the day jobs. Between stints on the road with heavyweights like AC/DC and Judas Priest, singer Joe Elliott spent his days working on construction sites.
Peter and Cliff, who were managing it by then, said, we can't afford wages, there's no money. And I had to go and work on a building site. Having had a top 20 album in England and a top 50 album almost in America, the first one, I'm on a building site. I'm sorry, but it's true.
The band believed their third album would be their final chance to escape from the monotony of home. The band wasn't sure what it would take to raise the standards. To help their chances, they recruited songwriter turned producer Robert John Langer, the man they called Mutt.
This guy was the best producer on the planet. Mutt Langer records always stand up. They're just, you know, they're classics.
Mutt Langer was one of the most sought-after music producers in the business. He powered Foreigner's 4 up the charts and sent AC/DC's Back in Black into rock history. And while he routinely thrusted acts into the limelight, the man himself was, and still remains, obsessive about his own privacy.
He does his job in the studio, and when the album's finished, that's as far as it goes with him. You know, the band go out and do all the TV exposure and do all the shows, and he just stays in the studio. And that's the way he likes it, you know. You got to respect that.
Though Def Leppard's second album, High and Dry, sold only 250,000 copies, Mutt Langer still believed in them. He thought they could even topple the mighty AC/DC, if properly guided.
Mutt, I think, looked at Def Leppard like a painter looks at not quite a blank canvas, but I guess a canvas full of manipulatives that we could just do whatever he wanted with. And
he knew something that we didn't at the time, and he impressed that upon us.
Mutt comes in with this idea, we could really kick the rock music up the ass and give it a real breath of fresh air.
We became sort of followers for a while.
In January 1982, Leppard made a deal with Langer. He'd get them out of Sheffield if they gave him total control.
We'd put ourselves in Mutt's hands. We didn't know how to get to the other end. And I don't even think Mutt did, but he just wanted to give it a try, and he had five willing volunteers.
In 1982, rock and roll was looking for a new savior. Def Leppard and their producer Mutt Langer set out to answer the call with Pyromania.
Mutt told us that his vision of this album was not to just do High and Dry 2, but to do an album that nobody had ever made before.
In January 1982, the band moved into Mutt Langer's studio. From day one, Langer made it clear to the band not to get too attached to anything. Lucky for Leppard, they'd yet to write a single song.
We specifically didn't even bother trying to come up with finished songs. We just loaded a tape machine after tape machine after tape machine of guitar riffs and guitar parts. We then started pulling all these little ideas and making them into songs with Mutt there, because that was the important part.
And we literally wrote that album on the spot.
Sometimes it took heavenly inspiration to get the process moving.
When we had the backing track for Rock of Ages, we were just singing dead and dead hell, dead and dead hell, because we didn't have any lyrics. And we'd let somebody use the studio the night before, I think. Somebody had left a Bible in the studio and it was open to the hymn Rock of Ages. And I picked it up and started singing Rock of Ages. And it was like Mutt just turned around and went, wow, that's it, that's it, that's the chorus. Swear to God, no pun intended.
Divine intervention aside, the recording process was painfully slow. Mutt insisted the album be recorded one finely tuned string, one precision beat at a time.
Mutt doesn't record albums, he builds them brick by brick, stone by stone.
He wanted something that was as near perfect. He wanted as much control over the whole sound of the record as he could possibly get.
It was doing it an instrument at a time and layering and layering and layering. We weren't in the business by now of recording the band in a studio like you see in movies.
Langer had a vision of how he wanted to record Pyromania, a vision that included replacing Rick Allen's beats with an electronic drum machine.
He decided that to have the perfect drum sound, you couldn't do it. You couldn't do it with real drums.
So we're like going, he's lost it. He's gone mad. Because he'd really got off on the idea of things like Human League when they did like Don't You Want Me Baby. Don't you want me, baby? Don't you want me, oh. He wanted to bring that pop element into the rock thing. And of course, you know, Rick quite probably was totally against the idea.
I played everything on the first album, played everything on the second album, and now I'm faced with, you know, just dissecting everything, looking at everything in its most minute detail. So I was like, is he insane?
In the struggle that ensued, the freewheeling rock band would be forced to march in perfect time.
It was rigidly in time because it was a machine. And at that stage, we weren't used to playing to a machine. Unless you keep your concentration up 100% all the time, it gets very difficult to play in that regimented way.
As the tedious recording process dragged on for months, the band members grew increasingly despondent.
And when he's saying, look, you can do it better, all you're wanting to do is go, no, I bloody well can't. This is as good as it gets. He goes, well, it ain't good enough then.
When you'd played something through, then you'd realise that you'd maybe got to play it another four times because you were double-tracking it a couple of times and then putting another inversion on, and I don't know, you know, it would get to you a bit.
Mutt Langer's relentless campaign for excellence drove the Leppards crazy. Some, like Pete Willis, turned more and more to alcohol.